Great. So welcome everyone to our sustainability session today. We have the Magenta Project talking to us about female empowerment and within sailing and how they're helping to develop female leaders. So a little bit about how this relates to World Sailing and our Agenda 2030 goals, which is our sustainability agenda. We have the target to promote activities to encourage and tackle social inclusion within sailing. And then we have also set the target to work with partners to create a career pathway for women with the target of achieving the same representative ratio of male and female and professional sailors in our ID system. Now, we've recognised Magenta Project recently with our Sustainability Award. They were our winner last year. And their work around female empowerment and development within the sport. So without further ado, I'll hand over to Meg and she can lead us through.
All right, thank you so much, Rebecca. Does everybody see this screen with the Magenta Project logo? Thumbs up? No, we don't see it? Are we,
yeah,
is it up? Yeah, it's okay, great. I will love to use the chat function in this and for everybody to introduce themselves of what's your role and where you're logging in from, any organization that you're affiliated with, just to kind of get that global feeling. I know that a lot of you are logging in from around the world at all different hours, so we're very excited to have you here chatting about empowering female leaders. So this is a metric that I like to start off with. It may be familiar to you, some of you. It may seem extreme to some. But essentially, in the 2021 International Maritime Organization report, it was estimated that about 3% of all international seafarers are women. That may seem like a skewed number, especially at a grassroots level. We have a lot of women in leadership. We have a lot of women in junior sailing programs, about 50-50, a nice mix. But then once you start going up to higher levels in our sport, this number starts to look more realistic. I'm going to give a very personal example. I just finished up the St. Martin Heineken Regatta. We had over 100 boats, and guess how many female skippers there were? Three. So that is just an example of, you know, at the highest level, there are plenty of women who are involved in all the teams, but we still don't have that equal number of female captains. However, it is very, very, I guess, encouraging the numbers that we do see across the grassroots level, such as within the St. Martin Heineken Regatta, there was a next generation series of races, and there were plenty of female and male skippers, all different ages and races. So I think that there is a lot of hope, and there are a lot of initiatives that are ensuring that we do have more diverse talent in development. But you can see that our current metric numbers, especially as a high level, for women in leadership positions, such as a skipper role, this is more representative to about 3%. Just to give you a little background on, if you don't know what the Magenta Project is, it was started out of the Team SCA Volvo Ocean Race campaign in 2014 and 15. And after that campaign, after these women had achieved first place coming into France, they showed that they could compete with the men, that they had not been receiving phone calls after the Volvo Ocean Race had ended for them. So they created this charity and support network and eventually a mentoring program to help bridge that gap so that more women, talented women, were receiving the right kind of opportunities that they deserved. So I would love for you, if you want to start, start putting into the chat where you're from, but also I want to ask a big question. So why do we think that this number is close to 3%? What's going on currently? And I really would love for this to be interactive because there's so many different factors, and Magenta Project really tries to address as many as possible, but there are unique journeys and different classes that are further along their DEI journey than others, or certain nations that have invested in more development for women. So I'd love to know from just a global perspective, and you could pop it in the chat, why do we think that this number is at 3%? Why are women not having, why are we not seeing women prevalent, whether it be at the highest level of our sport or more female skippers? Anybody have any ideas? Or feel free to come in and chime in. I'll start us off. I think that really, from my perspective, is that we don't have enough women in higher level roles to inspire and bring up more women into leadership and opportunities and be able to create teams that support female development. I know that in the recent years, the solution to getting more women on professional sports teams has been the use of quotas. And I welcome anyone who has a personal opinion on quotas to please share it. But it is not necessarily the right solution. And we keep trying to kind of feed women in from the bottom into different high level sports teams, or, you know, even different events are starting to have crew requirements so that it's 50-50 male and female, which is great. But despite that, we still aren't seeing any female skippers. The last Ocean Race, for example, had some crew requirements for men and women balance, but not a single female skipper was within the program. So we're really trying with the Magenta Project to kind of break down systemically what are the barriers that women are facing in our industry so that we can help empower them and move them forward, but also provide the opportunities. So a lot of times we hear things like, oh, maybe the women aren't skilled enough. We hear that, oh, we don't know enough women and we don't have the connections with them. And I'm sure they're out there, but we just don't know them. Oftentimes it comes from a multi-stakeholder approach in terms of who is responsible for empowering and supporting women to be able to further their careers and help us have this number be more reflective of actually participation with women in our societies, but also in our sport, because that 3%, a lot of times in sailing, especially our grassroots community, that just doesn't seem right. However, as they go further down their journeys, you see the dropout rates coming from junior sailing programs. So it's really like, why is this number here? Why is it not moving? And what can we do to make an impact of it? And this is a commitment that really needs to be done at a institutional and kind of global level for us to be able to support women to the top. So our mission statement at the Magenta Project is driving change and inspiring gender equality, equity, and inclusion through our global sports network. I think what's really important about this, and really what's important with any mission statement, is that the intention is what really drives the impact. And I will go through in this presentation a couple of different organizations that we worked with that wanted, maybe not necessarily within their mission statement, but within their codes of conduct or within their class rules or their class vision, that they have some kind of gender sustainability policies and that they want to support women in their development, but also protect them when we start to bring them into these environments that maybe they haven't been welcome in before. So it's really the intention set out that really helps us as a global community and society, that if we can get behind this mission together that we want to develop more women, then we can set up the type of systems and processes to be able to make it happen. So just an overview about, okay, so how do we make this happen? What is the model? And what do we do at the Magenta Project to make this work? I know that, and I see that you're sharing now where you're coming from, so please continue to do so. We have sailors, we have program leaders, we have the UK from New Zealand. So really, this is a global interest for us all to be investing really more time, energy, and resources into empowering more women to get to the top of our sport. So our work is developed on the mentoring program model, which is kind of our core flagship program. We also do a lot of outreach and networking to help build, break down those barriers to why some women can't make the right connections to get where they want in their career. Also the talent development. So to break down that barrier of, oh, they don't have enough skills, they don't have enough experience. So we created particular internships and experience to help overcome those barriers. And finally, policy and consulting, and really developing policies and procedures to protect and safeguard women as well. We have seen now in a lot of, at the highest level, at the IMOCA level of the sport, where the boat finally is supportive platform, because it also goes back to boat and gender design. Are there some boats that from the drawing board actually are not inclusive designs for women. And we see that with like the Volvo 65, for example. Somebody like Cole Brower was told that she couldn't do the Southern Ocean, but on that boat particularly, because that wasn't the right size for her. You may be familiar with this woman. She's about to now finish the global solo race on a class 40. Alone, the solo part, and she is in second place. So she is capable. She has the skill and the passion and drive, and she's also found the appropriate boat and platform for her. So I want to go into a little bit more deep dive into, okay, where are these other barriers and challenges happening? Are they coming from a class level where we can institute policy, or is it going as far back as how we're designing boats that may not be inclusive for women either? So from the mentoring program perspective, it's been running since 2018. We've launched a curriculum particularly for mentee skill development in 2022. And we have a variety of different pathways, which we think are really important in not only focusing our mentees on kind of what part of the sport is their playing field, but also how we can further develop the connections and support network to help them develop a career in these particular pathways. So that's from the beginning where they're matched with a mentor. So they apply into whatever particular pathway is most related to their career goals in sailing. And then we will have them matched up with a mentor who has similar career experiences, and we'll be able to help them refine and connect, make the connections for their goals. And at the end of this, if we still have time, I'll kind of walk you through the type of mentor training that we do to help them guide through that process. But on the mentee side, we also have somewhat of like peer mentoring that we've established with this monthly curriculum. It runs for 9 months. You can see from October to June. And that has a variety of different core building blocks, from core career skills like CVs and career mapping, campaign and sponsorships, all the way down into related skills in particular fields, and to give them a full wide breadth of possibilities for their careers, because some may come from inshore and an Olympic background, but not be familiar with offshore until they see that there are many past Olympians that have gone offshore, and that also could be maybe a career pathway for themselves. So our curriculum and our communication is always about inspiring and educating these women to be able to see the potential for themselves and also see other women who are achieving these things. So, for example, we have the Offshore Pathways webinar that's coming up, and Pam Lee, which is one of our mentors, she will be part of that. She just completed the TJV double-handed in the Class 40 as well. So having these near-peer mentors and inspirational women within our network that open up their time and have a platform to just allow these women who are developing their careers to know that there is an entire network behind them, and that they can ask kind of like, what would you ask your future self if you were going down that pathway? And we have plenty of women in our entire network, and men as well, that are on these various points in their own pathways. And we try to connect and inspire women through that. So visualization and also connecting women to their future selves is really core to how we start to empower women and inspire them to be more proactive, to be more confident, and to be more significant players in our sport. So then when it comes to the mentor side of things, in 2023, so just this past October, we established a mentor training curriculum. A lot of these mentors that work with us, not all of them are past coaches. And even those who are coaches only know how to work with performance-oriented goals on the water. And this is an entirely remote program where we work with women virtually. Their mentors maybe not even meet. We, of course, encourage it, but it may be not possible for them to meet. So it's all about really taking a step off of the boat and thinking about, what are you doing today? What are you doing tomorrow? And what can you do to be able to set and properly assess and reach the goals that they come into the program with that intention. Having goal setting is really core to, again, the empowerment and, but really the retention of women in these programs. When we think about the dropout rates after junior sailing, opties, you know, or even college sailing after that, why are we losing women just like after they go through the junior sailing program? Why do they just completely drop out? And if anyone who works with women in that level and sees that dropout and wants to share personal reflections, please do and add them to the chat, and we'll be sure to export, you know, kind of all of this feedback. But essentially, you know, when you don't have a goal in mind, then there's really, when you encounter challenges such as past opties, there's not many boats that may be encouraging for women to go take on. It may be that these young female sailors don't have keelboat experience, and then that's the next place up. They don't have the connections to the keelboat owners, and we don't have a lot of female keelboat owners. And that is also impacting the opportunities for women, because we know that more women are bringing on more women on board their boats. And sometimes it can take a little bit more convincing for the guys to open up, you know, which is normally a boat full of their friends and a time for them to, you know, usually previously there weren't that many mixed teams. And now it's becoming more norm. So how do we help support women to find these opportunities, but also thrive in them? So this gut dives in more into that kind of leadership development and core confidence building. So previously for the mentee curriculum, what we work with them on webinars is their core skill development and education in the industry. And then the mentors are the ones who help them develop that core confidence, mental strengthening, understanding their own values and drivers and strengths, and really helping them to craft what is the best approach for what they want to achieve in their particular career related to sailing. So the formatting of this is just half hour sessions once a month. And this is also we talk about sustainability and that kind of strategy. This is our sustainability and scalability strategy for the Magenta project. It is very challenging and a very long process for us to be bringing in mentees and looking through all of the applications and then finding the right kind of mentor for them. Also, mentorship that's more near home is more enduring and more relevant to kind of what these women are experiencing and what they're going through. We're lucky that we are working with women at a super high level. So they've already kind of exhausted their local connections and are therefore looking for the next international connection and level up in their industry. So that's really what our international mentoring program helps achieve. However, there's so many women, everything from like Olympic campaigns and many women who are competing in the Olympics this year, and it may be their final campaign. What do we do with these women? Do we have within our M&As the ability to help support them through the next stage of their career because Olympics is no longer that goal? And what do we do with people who have been dedicated the majority of their adult life, using the Olympic example, to one goal that now has either been achieved or maybe not achieved? And how do you then translate that passion and energy into something else that still keeps them fulfilled and engaged with the sport? So that's why constant goal setting and reassessment and this process that we're really helping these mentors learn and how to be a best mentor is really core to the success of this mentoring model. So aside from the mentoring program, we also want to work on hard skills. So as often as we can, we are running clinics and internships. And I think that this is something that hopefully you guys can all take to your local programs and organizations. Find partnerships within the industry that support this mission and female development. I think that it's pretty trendy these days, so you shouldn't find it's too hard to kind of get your local sailmaker on board. If you are lucky enough to be in a place where there's a shipbuilding culture, we would need more women in boat building, do a site visit, create opportunities for them to have engaging conversations. This is all really core talent development stuff and opportunities that will help us build the future of talented women. But this is not stuff that happens overnight. This needs to be a constant investment and also part of your strategy to create opportunities. And oftentimes, so we'll have like, okay, you have a diesel course, for example, a diesel engine course. You're like, oh, well, we had this, but only men signed up. Well, it'd be interesting. It was actually proven with Foiling Week that Foiling Week for a while had offered free foiling clinics. And so that they said, okay, you can come, you can try foiling. And it was only men who showed up. Then they started to say, we have specific women's only foiling clinics. And all of a sudden that was oversubscribed by women. So sometimes women do not feel welcome in especially technical or high level roles because they haven't seen themselves in them, or they've not been given that opportunity to try or to pursue or you know, discover something like that. So it's really important if you want to do skills development, we want to be inclusive, but sometimes it's also valuable to then set aside a specific, this is a women's development thing. This is a women's offshore event. This is a women's sailmaker thing. And the numbers will be much higher in the investment and the subscribing into those types of events when you specifically say, this is for you. And the reason why is because, again, women are not feeling as welcome. However, if you put an identifier that they identify and say, hey, I already checked that box. I'm a woman. So this already I'm qualified for. And if you give them more opportunities for them to feel like they're qualified, that's what helps empower them and help them lean in more on these opportunities in the industry. So furthering that on is communication and outreach. So networking is a big core part of this. We do a panel type of model, and we've used platforms such as the Ocean Race, where there's a lot of attention, a lot of excitement, but really trying to push the agenda forward and not just applaud ourselves from how far we've come, but really have an honest conversation about how far we still need to go. So On the Horizon was that series that we hosted during the Ocean Race. And we really tried in each of the locations we hosted to bring in a local and a grassroots type of perspective, as well as an international perspective on what are the challenges for equity and inclusion in our sport in this particular region. So if you're looking for, you know, this type of experience for if you're at a local level, your local yacht club, you're wondering why there aren't more women on crew or women are having crew matching issues, host some kind of interactive panel or even just a networking event for, you know, more women to feel comfortable, to be able to interact. It can be intimidating to go up to people on boats and ask for rides. However, again, if you set it up and you say, hey, you're welcome to this, you're invited to this, they feel more like this. These are opportunities for them. And then they can continue to feel that this is a community that supports women and their development. So continuing to build out. Our global talent network is another thing that makes women feel welcome, confident, and supported, because no matter where they go, if they're going to start a new job in France and they're coming from the UK and they don't speak the language, we have a group of Magenta people in a lot of the core cities around France. We have women who are part of our program who have applied from Japan. They have to go outside of the country in order to seek and further develop their skills. So one of them is in Australia now, and we matched her with Nick Douglas, because Nick Douglas, if you know her, she's the great connector. And so while she's going offshore and she needs to pursue connections and things in that realm, Nick Douglas, who comes from more of a media background, she's really all about the connections. And that's what Arisa has been able to really enjoy are the connections that Nick Douglas has helped put her together with. And as a result, she's been able to reach one of her first goals from joining the program, which is to do the Sydney Hobart race. So these are just a few examples of how, you know, working with the Magenta Project, and we encourage you all to reach out and see how your organization or your team may be able to kind of join the Magenta network. because we have plenty of people who really want to support each other. And it's a lot easier if we all work and drive these things forward together. So this is final, but really, really important. Policy and consulting is a big part of the work that we do. We have worked with Amoca particularly through a lot of their challenges that they've had with some issues, all the way from Clarice, who had lost her sponsor, Banque Populaire, if you may remember, last year, after she had given birth to her child. So that, and I do encourage everyone, if you haven't already read it, we have a maternity policy recommendation piece. This just gives an example of a multi-stakeholder approach to policies that help support and protect and empower women to further and continue on their careers. So maternity and the choice to be a mother should not be exclusionary or mutually exclusive to being an athlete. And this particular piece does look into other sports like tennis and running, who have worked into their policies ways to help not further disadvantage women who have chosen to be mothers, as well as just a conscious understanding of that this is a multi-stakeholder approach and necessity, such that everyone from the sailor themselves should have some type of maternity policy clause in their contract and protections, to the race organizations that can potentially have some kind of seating or status rule, because that was a big thing with the Vendée Globe and how their new rules affected her eligibility to be in the next round of the racing. But also from a sponsorship perspective, a lot of these companies are organizations that their employees have a robust maternal policy or something like that. However, for some reason, sports athletes, which are essentially employees of their sponsors, do not have the same protections. So as a sport, or really just sporting in general, is trying to find more policies and procedures and strategic approaches to be able to help break down these barriers. We had a conversation in one of our On the Horizon advocacy panels about how we don't have a lot of judges or PROs that are women. So how do we combat that? And one of the things that was brought up as an example is to have childcare facility and opportunities at these type of regattas so that their kids can be taken care of, as it's a weekend usually. And so that will help alleviate the stress on mothers, but also hours and opportunities for them to balance both work and their family life. So you see that happening in corporations, that we're becoming more adaptable to the needs of women who really want to and can do it all, but that they shouldn't be punished because they've chosen motherhood and they also want to choose being a performance athlete. So this is an example, but there's also even deeper examples, one of them particularly being safeguarding for women, women being now part of these formerly and still male-dominated communities. How can we ensure that there are procedures as well as proper protocol for women to be able to, in a anonymous and safe way, come forward to an organization if they have experienced sexual harassment or other discriminatory experiences? And this doesn't only go for women, of course, but we are finding that a lot of the things that women need for safeguarding are other minority and vulnerable groups also need in terms of safeguarding. So if we can figure out how do we protect 50% of the population who is still marginalized, we can figure out policies and structure to also protect and therefore create welcoming, safe, and supportive environments for more diverse talent in our sport. I'm gonna stop there for a second because I know that I just dumped a lot. I would love to open up for questions before I go into a little exercise. So that was a big, big zoom out. You know, what can we do as a global sport? World Sailing is bringing us together to even have this conversation. So it's a fantastic platform for us all to be here together and have it. But then this is a little bit more of a workshop type experience that we do with mentors to help go through the process. So how do you really work one-on-one with a mentee? How do you drive the pathway? Because ultimately everything can be set up for them. We could pave it in gold, but it's ultimately up to them to make the steps forward, to feel confident, empowered, and become the future leaders of our sport. So I'm going to pause on stuff that I, on this before I go into this little workshop. I know that there's a lot of also input into the chat, so I'm going to kind of read over it. Does anyone want to pop in with a particular question on the stuff that I just covered? Anything resonate with anybody? Like, oh yes, we've done this and this works, or oh wow, this is kind of a new approach and I think we might try this out. Nobody today.
Feel free to turn on your mics and ask questions as well.
I'm going to leave an open space. I'm going to keep reading because I'm going to make the silence so awkward that somebody's going to have to ask a question. So I see a lot about the maritime industry and just kind of being a male-dominated space. I'm going to go back real quickly to something that I did mention about the intention and having the mission to be able to support more women. So Future Fibers, which is a company that we work with. I don't know how many of you are familiar with Future Fibers as a brand, but if you've seen any Imoca 60 race or the America's Cup or SailGP, Future Fibers is the carbon rigging that is holding those masts up. And it's a super high technical company, which oftentimes it's not something that you can learn in school. So we've had a lot of women in our program who have been really supported and mentored through Future Fibers because the company and its highest leadership, male, has it set the intention that they want to make an impact on that 3% number. And they already have with that intention as a STEM company and a very high level product and service. They have 30% of their workforce being female, which is really incredible for such a high level STEM company, because we usually see those numbers being closer to 3%. And the reason being is because they specifically set out the intention. And the general manager even told me that he won't even look at male applications anymore. So they have taken that upon themselves to be able to invest and push forward. And I think that that's really admirable, and that we hope that more companies will take that initiative. And also we have more companies that are reaching out to the Magenta Project to be looking into how can they run this mentoring model internally to help develop more female leaders and talent within their company. So that's where the multi-stakeholder approach really comes in, and also policy. So, okay, we want to bring in more women, great. But do you have an environment that is supportive of women? Because previously there were no women here. So even thinking about toilet facilities is an example that a lot of these places where it's like the men's bathroom's the main one and the girls is in the back, or it's a storage room, or it's something separate. So thinking about how to make spaces physically welcoming for women or different people, even inclusion, diversity, and mixed ability. If your club doesn't have a ramp, how can somebody feel, who's a wheelchair user, feel welcome in your space and at your club? I have been at yacht clubs where I've been told in a joking way by some male hosts that, oh, this room used to be where women weren't even allowed in it. And I know that that's history that we probably all wish would just burn, but it's still prevalent in yacht club cultures and the old school kind of mentality. But think about ways that we can reverse that. with women's nights, women's racing, you know, special experiences and workshops, networking, just to make women feel more welcome in a space where for centuries they were physically restricted from participating. I'm just going back through some of the notes in the chat. So I see building a peer network and community. All right. Well, if you want to pop in any other tips, tricks, or examples, I really do welcome you to add that in there. And yes, I thank you, Lisa, for adding that. Yes, it can be used as a grassroots level. This is not just to the top of our sport. And I think that this is a great segue into this little interactive workshop and understanding on what point of the pathway your potential mentee is on and how you can help them envision what are the milestones along the way and what can we do to help them get there. So or if we just go back to this getting to goal setting, remember that I talked about one of the big things with retention is that women don't have enduring goals in the sport, mostly because there's too many challenges and barriers for them to continue pursuing those goals, or that they just don't even think that they're possible. So, you know, stories like Cole Brower is showing women that sailing solo around the world is totally possible and that you could be feminine, unapologetically feminine while you're doing it. And that we don't have to look like men, act like men, be like men in order to sail against men. So I think that these kind of stories are really important and connecting women with, again, their future selves and seeing their future selves so that they can help envision. And really, it has to be self-empowerment. We can do so many things to help, like I said, paint the pathway in gold, but it will take these women and support of a mentor to be able to really position them to be empowered and become the future leaders that we know women deserve and can be for our communities. So when we're talking about in a career pathway or even just, you know, your local sailing community and how do you support what you see a really, really talented young woman that has a lot of passion and drive, but she is, you know, graduating or she's out of the junior sailing program or she didn't make Olympic trials and now she needs to figure out where else to go in her career and if sailing is worth all the energy and investment. So the first step in that is really a mentee self-assessment. And so what does that mean? I'm going to use this a lot is based on an academic leadership development model. So I'm going to talk about superpowers, which if anyone of you are in a leadership background, that may be familiar. But superpowers are, you know, what is your flow? What are the things that when you do them, you know, you could do it forever. It makes you happy. It's your thing. That's what you own. And really understanding in that self-assessment also, what are your values and drivers? A big part of sometimes when women are not finding the right team or gel for them is because oftentimes that team or organization may not share the same core values. So there may be some women that have no problem with, you know, the use of discriminatory names or slang or things like that. That doesn't deter them. They, you know, they like the kind of boys' locker room thing. They thrive off of it. They're one of the guys and they like that. Okay, fine. They don't have a problem with that. But there are some others who think that that's super disrespectful and can't function in a team environment like that. So doing a self-assessment with a mentee and understanding like really what are their core values and drivers, that can help be something that you can tap into later when they address certain challenges and or roadblocks that they're coming up to. So it's like, okay, well, what is this that's really causing an issue for you? And how does that relate to your core values and drivers? And is this something that can be overcome? Or is this circumstances that are not in your control, but really rock your core and are not a good fit for you. And just having that ability, you know, you're kind of like that inner voice for them, but without all the self-doubt. So it's super important to be able to have these conversations and continuing to revisit them. And I did just see a chat pop in, is that to what extent are men involved in this conversation, and are they hearing this kind of thing? I can say that for the Magenta Project, we have probably like 40% of our mentors are men, and they're almost always on all of our mentor training sessions. They certainly are there and supportive, but I wouldn't say that it's the same numbers of support we have for women, of course. I think that it is, when we talk about creating events that are specific for women that make them feel comfortable and help them develop their skills and networking, great. But also, we had the experience for the On the Horizon panels, that this was a conversation about equity and inclusion. However, it was almost like the opposite, where it was the diverse group, it was all women who were attending and not the people who necessarily needed to hear it. So it is a challenge, and I don't have the full solution of how do we have men not only actively involved in this conversation, but actively involved in the process. But I will say that the most successful examples are my girl dads. And I know that some women are like, oh, you hear it all the time, is that, oh, now that you have a daughter, now you care about women. But realistically, it's kind of true. And for men who don't grow up with female counterparts, like sisters or female leaders outside of their mother, they have a challenge with seeing females as equal peers, and also as potential leaders that don't come into that mom or teacher idea. So I think what we really need are more female leaders, so that we can shift the relationship between men and women, so that men who have women above them is not their mom or their, you know, elementary school teacher. It's men who admire and really refer to these women and see them as the leaders that they are. And in a situation that is more equal and more valued for females, and not necessarily because of gender. So I can get into a lot of psychology and deep into Freudian stuff too, but I think really what we need in order to be able to empower women, bring them up to the highest level, is to invest time, energy, and resources into those female leaders. Because for the past history of the world, men have received this privilege. Men have had mentors. Men have been brought up. Men have been given the opportunities. Men have gotten the phone calls. Men have had the connections. So we need to come and overcome a history of not getting the phone calls, which is why the Magenta Project was started, not having dedicated mentors, because that's why we just have a pipeline of male leaders. It's one male leader to the next male leader, handed off to the next male leader. So to really kind of break that cycle, we need to invest strategically as a sport and organization to be able to invest in more female leaders, which will then bring up more women. I see that we have some more feedback in the chat, but I will just go back. I'll revisit the chat in a second. But when we're talking about how do you motivate women and how do you continue to help them see the goals and mapping out their career pathway, it's going to be, after that, a self-assessment. What are their core values? It's exploring those pathways. So the mentoring program with Magenta does it in a very structured way through our 9-month curriculum. However, you can do it with your mentee or the women in your grassroots communities to be able to see and explore pathways by bringing in examples, doing, you know, doc talk nights. You can call it Magenta and see if we can do a webinar to be able to chat and inspire and do these kind of things, so that women can really see the pathway opportunities. The next part of that is very related is, okay, so you see the pathway. Now, what are the kind of building blocks along the way, and what are the connections to help get you there? What are the bridges we can build? So building authentic connections, again, meant the networking opportunities. Bring in more women together. There'll be more female teams if you connect more females together. There'll be more mixed teams if you connect them with the greater community. So creating more authentic and genuine networking opportunities and skill building will help create more women participants at a serious and enduring level. Going back to, again, this is a unique journey. Not everybody can have the same journey. So you're building these authentic connections while coming back to what is the mentee's unique story and how does this play into their journey and what connections can you bring in to help really write that story? What do you see ahead of them? Because we know people who have similar pathways. So listen to your mentee and then think about, what does that sound like? Who do I know who has had similar journey? It will never be the same, but connecting them with different points of their journey that where they find inspirations or guides or other fellow mentors, really understand that you cannot be all end all for your mentee. Bring in other people to help support. So it's not be all end all for your women in your grassroots industry. Invite them to look into the Magenta Project, you know, connect them with global resources so that they can even see beyond the club what opportunities there are and feel like there's an entire world of support behind them. And that helps with confidence too, knowing that you have kind of a global village behind you. Then ensuring that time, energy, resources are spent into mastering the basics. So, okay, what's your goal? Well, what kind of skills do you need to get there? And setting them up with things. Let's try to avoid financial barriers and other things that are preventing maybe women from attending at a high level. So if we can get sponsored things, if we can get, you know, free sale making clinics from your local sale maker, see how you can do these type of initiatives without creating more barriers such as financial ones. Another one is managing expectations. So, you know, if you have a female that's trying out for a team on a boat that, like, we go back to, there are a lot of boats that are not from the drawing board designed for women. I know there's even some J boats that it's very difficult due to the winch size for women to be trimmers. And even, you know, like 30 something foot boats, it's just not made for the upper body of a woman. It's made for the upper body of a man. So thinking about leverage, thinking about these things. So managing expectations is also, let's think about what the challenge is. Is this a circumstance or solvable problem? A circumstance is a boat that simply is not designed for you. You can't overcome that. That's the circumstance that unfortunately you're going to have to figure out another route or another way to achieve your goal because you can't change that circumstance. Or is it a problem? Is a problem that, no, this boat is great for you, but you just can't find the right kind of skipper or team to support you. So thinking about and managing expectations of where are these real core barriers and challenges and how we can reverse engineer solutions for them. And the biggest thing is reviewing, revising, resetting, and repeating. So review these goals, have often conversations with them, your mentee. Their goals may change. They may find certain challenges not worth the pursuit anymore, but they want to kind of what it is revised. So after that review process, you can look at what can we do differently if we're still keep, you know, reaching a brick wall. And sometimes a reset is needed. Sometimes it's just like, okay, we need to just stop this and completely pivot. We need to start over. We need to try a different boat, and that's okay. And it takes a lot of confidence and courage to be able to completely reset. But I know personally that it's worth the journey and it saves you a lot of time and energy in the long run. But these mentees can't do it alone. They need the process. They need the support to be able to talk through these challenges in order to continue to revise and advance their goals. And finally, repeat the whole process, go through the self-assessment, go through the pathways, the connections, their story, going back to mastering the basics and always managing expectations. A big thing that I've had, and I did a similar talk at the US Sailing Conference last month, And I had quite a few program directors come up to me and say, oh, I have this amazing woman in my program. I'd love for her to step up and be a leader, maybe the future program director, but she just doesn't have the confidence, but you know, she's amazing. She's so great. And I said to her, I was like, well, do you tell her that? Do you tell her that she's so great? Do you tell her how amazing she is? You point out the things that she does really well and encourage her. And most of the time when we have a confidence issue, it's because they aren't hearing that positive, uplifting stuff enough. They're not believing it. They're not buying it. So how can we really work in investing positive affirmations through inspirational stories saying, yes, you're on the right path. Look at Cole. Cole did it too. Or even more intrinsically in terms of, you know, you're really great and you should feel really proud about this particular program that you did and super valuable. And how would you want to take that value and that passion and that talent that you have to the next level of your career? And I will, and kind of like final thoughts, very much caution in the process of mentoring a mentee that we are not imposing our own wants, hopes, needs, desires, experiences onto them. I know that a lot of succession planning, that we want more female leaders and that you want to push them into these roles, which they do need to push and they do need the confidence. However, if it's not right for them, it's not right for them. So these conversations, the constant revision, the constant coming back and reviewing will help prevent your organizations from being blindsided by a talented female leaving your program or not continuing. And oftentimes, if you just had those conversations, it'd be a lot easier to prevent that blindside or help them overcome or revise or pivot whatever is needed before they completely give up and leave. So I'm going to just go to the kind of the final slide. If you are interested in working with the Magenta Project, exploring the mentoring model, seeing what kind of resources we have available, follow the Magenta Project on Facebook and Instagram. That's great to see, kind of get inspired. What are we doing? What are our women doing? What are great programs around the world doing? And then also you can always reach out to me, contact@themagentaproject.org, and we can start to chat about, you know, specifically what your organization needs, what maybe the Magenta Project can do to support you, and what are your organizational goals, and how we can help drive those goals with your female talent that you have available. So I've done a lot of talking. Is there anybody who wants to kind of summarize? I'm going to go back into the chat because I think it's important, but I'm going to be quiet for a second. If there's anyone who, or Rebecca, I don't know if there's anything that you pulled out of the chat as a key takeaway or example or something we should address.
No, thank you, Meg. That was great. And I'm sure everyone else found it really informing and interesting. I'll just pull it up. Katie's comments. So, she's a former 29 sailor, and you know, growing up, going through from junior to maybe more youth and then potentially looking at more serious Olympic stuff, that gender split only really happens when you get to kind of like the Olympic classes. And I think coming on my own experience and also Katie's, it obviously the progression, like women and men are compared a lot to each other within those teenage years. And unfortunately, some boats just suit men better because of their strength. And once they've gone through that puberty, I've had it, being like fairly close to someone, all of a sudden they're super strong or in comparison to other people and already a light year above. And it's not necessarily because you can't do X, Y, or Z. It's just the physical nature of the sport. So yeah, and boarding on Katie's, it might lead to a lack of confidence, losing interest, and like the passion for pushing themselves harder, because even if they push themselves harder, maybe they can't win that race or this, that, or the other. So I think that was a really interesting comment. And you know, she's not suggesting that we shouldn't compare them, but, and it also potentially does make those women tough, but it's just how we go about it and protecting them and also fostering what's next once you stop. You know, I think building on an own experience and what I see, especially in the UK and the younger sailors, we push the pathway, the Olympic pathway, which is great. And But at the end of the day, that's not for everyone. And maybe other people don't know about the other opportunities in keelboat sailing, inshore racing, offshore racing, and how they can get involved through that. So I think like this session is great to build on that and educate more people and help potentially provide the next step that might not be that traditional Olympic step, but it's still within the world of sailing.
Absolutely. I think that this kind of comment gives a really great example of how the breadth of our sport and how we have so many different classes. And even to your example, Rebecca, that as junior sailors go through puberty, we are able to have them in a level playing field, but then the men do get stronger, they do get bigger. And how do we deal with a sport that has the unique opportunity to have men and women competing against each other, which is amazing. But also, yeah, how do we take that kind of flip side of having women being compared to unachievable standards by physical biology? But I think also taking a further zoom out and seeing that that's that boat, and that's that boat where size matters. But then there's also the IMOCA 60, where your team preparation, your brain, your ability to manage your resources and strategically think and do weather, that once we start getting away just from like the physicality of skills, that's when the playing field actually gets leveled. So I think it's always when we get caught up in these things of comparing ourselves to men or these challenges, zoom out and maybe see like, okay, maybe at this point, this is not the right class for me, but I see other women going into this one and that's where there's a better space. We have a hand.
Hi.
Siobhan.
Hi. Firstly, thanks for a great talk. I have a bit of a nebulous question to do with, I see a lot of my male peers and they are, you know, they're actively encouraging more female participation in the sport. But I feel like a lot of the time it's not that authentic. And so they're doing it because they know it's the right thing to do. But at the end of the day, that's just more competition for them as well. So I guess my question, I'm not exactly sure what my question is, but how do we encourage everyone in our community to actually buy into this in an authentic way so that we can reach our end goal, which is everyone getting the same chance to do the sport that we love without barriers based on something that's completely outside of our control?
No, that's a very good question. And I wish I had the perfect solution, but I do think that in terms of sustainability and bringing it all back, it's going to be a long endeavor. The shift's already happening. It may feel disingenuous. We have these quotas and things that are kind of forcing it in. But I'm hoping that these kind of quotas, the separation into, you know, Women's America's Cup and that kind of stuff is a pathway to then genuine and authentic equality. But it's going to take a lot more seasons of men having women on board boats and winning. It's going to take more seasons of women on podiums and coming in first and second places to round the world races. So really, it's just like it's a process, and it's a process of making a proof that women not only belong there, they're not being forced there, they're welcome. And there will be more women welcome when men see that you can't get on a podium anymore unless you have female sailors on board. And then they're gonna be the odd guys out. So it is tough to be in part of this journey where we're suffering through, we're blazing trails. But I do think that it is getting easier, and these kind of conversations and just, you know, having crew placement or really taking the opportunity to highlight the great women that are doing amazing things. I have to bring up, just because it's close to me, the St. Martin and Heineken Regatta. There's a, you know, a trophy for women in sailing that particularly highlights their roles. And last year it was given to a female bow woman. Who, you know, is not the skipper, is not listed on the scratch sheet, but she was on a Melgis, and we all know racing Melgis that the bow person is, you know, just as core to the team performance as the skipper is. So I think really pulling out these women, putting them in skipper, not putting them, but earning skipper roles, more female boat owners, more females in top tier positions. And then naturally the men will feel like, okay, this is something that I got to be part of, not because it's a good thing. It's because I'm going to win because of it. And that's really what motivates a lot of people is the performance.
The meritocracy. Cool. Thank you.
Yeah, for sure.
Amazing. If anyone has
at the end.
Yeah, if anyone else has any other questions for Meg, please turn on your mic or put your hand up, type it in the chat. We can hang on for a little bit longer. I'm sure that's fine. If you have any feedback from the session, it'd be really, really useful if you could quickly scan the QR code and provide us with some feedback, what you liked, what you didn't, what you'd like to see next, what other topics you think would be great to include within these sessions. And then our next session for this season is going to be in a couple weeks' time. The date has changed. It's going to be the 27th of March rather than the 20th, but we're going to have a talk on safeguarding whiteboard sailing. So we know it's become a more of a prevalent issue, as Meg mentioned earlier, and we have our integrity officer manager coming in to speak from World Sailing and De Villa, kind of show everyone the World Sailing safeguarding strategy and how it can be implemented for M&As, the likes of a big events as well, and how they can ensure that this is taken part of holistically within the sport. Cool. Meg, I think there was something else in the chat.
Oh, yes, Arisa, who I mentioned about achieving her goals and being connected. So, yeah, thank you, Arisa, for joining us. I know that it must be a crazy time for you. So that's dedication. And yeah, just examples of, you know, if you are in a community which is very difficult for women to connect with or further advance because it's just not available, please consider reaching out to the Magenta Project. If you really have, you know, a star sailor, somebody who wants to play in the international field of our sport, that's what the Magenta Project is really made for, in making those next level connections. I will just leave with kind of a overview of who is the right kind of candidate if you want to be a mentee or a mentor. So mentees are usually have to be over 18 and show they're usually from 18 to 40, usually within the 20 something to 30 range, usually within a transition in their career and have established goals of sailing being their career choice. So this is not for hobbyist sailors who just want to do some more RYA sailing. This is more for the people who want to develop sailing as a career path. And mentors, anybody who's been in the industry who may be interested in supporting and giving back, you'll be very surprised that I'm sure we'll find a mentee who is a good match for you. So the application process for mentors is always open, and mentees is open for the month of August. So if you're interested in joining the next cycle, look out for that in August.
Cool. Great. Well, there's no other questions. We'll leave it there. Thank you, everyone, so much for joining again. I think it's been a great conversation, and it's great to hear about this story. I have seen something that's come through the chat. So thank you, Anna, for joining. And it's good that this can be like translated to other sports as well, because it is, I'm sure it's not just an issue in sailing. It's going to be universal to sport. But thank you so much. And thank you again to Meg for delivering that. Hope everyone enjoyed. I'll be sharing the slides and the recording after the session, and as long with Meg's contact details, so you can get in touch if you have any further questions. Great.
Thanks everyone from logging in around the world. I love seeing where you're coming from, and please feel free to reach out to Magenta Project and share what your organization goals are, how we can help support you.
Yep. Perfect. Amazing. Cool. Lovely. Well, thank you, everyone. See you soon.
Thanks, everybody.